In this episode, we're going to talk about how you need to design for manufacturing. Now, this is a subject that's a bit tricky, so pay attention. There's a lot of information here on YouTube and also the internet about 3D printing and designing with SolidWorks or Fusion 360 or other 3D CAD programs. But they really don't explain what the process is for inventors. And let me get into detail about this. So let's suppose you're designing a simple part. Just because you can print it on a 3D printer does not mean that it can be injection molded or CNC'd. You have to understand how the various manufacturing processes work in order to design correctly and efficiently. And let's get into a little detail. Now, you guys may not even know the various types of manufacturing processes, so let's talk about the fundamental ones, the ones that are used the most. If you like what you've been learning so far, please be sure to subscribe, hit that notification bell, give me a thumbs up, and leave your comments below. Obviously, we have CNC manufacturing. Now, keep in mind that there's various levels of CNC. There's the CNC, which is three axis, where the bit just comes down, cuts in X and Y, and goes down slowly in the Z axis. And that uses a cutting tool to cut away the material. But even CNC can get more complicated than that. You can have five axis, apparently seven axis, nine axis machines. Now, this may sound like a great opportunity for you and your designs, but here's the problem. The more complex you get in your designs, the more expensive your parts become. If you remember my video where I talk about unleashing your artistic side, there's the other side that you also have to be aware of, which is the financial one. You need to make sure that you combine your art with your reality of what it's going to cost to make. And those two can be a little tricky to work out, but it's not as hard as it sounds. So when you're designing, we want to design simple parts as inventors that can be made on regular three-axis CNCs. You can get more complicated in the future when you're selling lots of product. But now when we're at the phase of 100 parts, a three-axis machine is all you want to build on. You want to keep the design simple and efficient for time. Remember, the more time that it takes to make each part, the more they're going to cost you. So it's just not about the material used. It's also about the time involved on the machine. And typically, you can use a number of about $75 an hour in a three-axis machine. So it's the cost of the materials plus the labor to make those 100 parts. And 100 parts could run you, and we're just talking parts, not the entire product, you know, 100 parts could take 4, 5, 6 hours to make. And that's not a bad estimate. So, you know, you're at, roughly in the top of my head, $10 a part for 100 parts in that scenario. So, think about that when you're coming up with your design, and make sure that you're designing efficiently for manufacturing, not for 3D printing or prototyping. Because then you'll go right from prototyping to manufacturing easier. So let's talk about a few of the other processes. After CNC manufacturing, you have injection molding. Now this is where it gets a little bit different. The CNC process is involved in making the mold. But once the mold is made, the two halves come together, inject plastic into it, open up, and the part drops out. But you have to know how to design those parts so that the mold is cheap to make. It's no longer an issue of how much material, because for the most part, the plastic material is cheap. It's the mold and all the intricacies that go along with it. As an example, if you have an egg-shaped product, the two halves will open up and the egg will fall right out because the surfaces are all curved. But if you try to make something, let's say this cup is a good example. If you try to make this cup this way, sure, you can come in on each sides, you can have the parting line here, the two halves will come apart, the part will pop out, but there's one catch. There's a hole in the center. You can't get the part out when it's molded. You also can't cut with a CNC inside without clearing all the material. So what you'll have is something that looks exactly like this cup with no inside. So how are you going to fix that problem if you're going to mold a cup like this? Well, you have to make what's called a slide. You have to have a third part that plugs in this area, but before the mold opens up, it pulls up so that the two halves can come out. I hope that makes sense. I hope you see that. We're going to be talking about this stuff a lot more, and I'm actually going to be designing some parts that are specifically for injection molding in the upcoming series. But right now we're finishing off with this Think Like an Inventor series so that you have the basic foundation of what it takes to get started. And I hope this series has helped you with that. The link to the playlist is down below. So now that you have a basic understanding of injection molding, let's talk about all the 2D type of manufacturing processes. That would be your laser cutters, your water jet machines, your plasma cutters, and things like that. They all work identical. It's just the type of cutting head that they use and also the materials that they're able to cut. A laser cutter, as an example, unless you have a big industrial one, is only going to cut acrylics, MDF, things like that. An industrial laser cutter can cut stainless steel, regular steel, and other very hard materials. But those are beyond the scope of most starting out inventors. So we're talking about regular laser cutters and things that you can make out of 2D. Now these you don't have too many issues with. You obviously know that when you make these parts, you're gonna have to cut through most of the time unless you're just engraving a logo or a name or something like that on top. But for the most part, they're 2D, they're cut out, and there are tricks how you can take these 2D parts and make them into 3D parts. When we're designing, we need to think and be aware of the types of manufacturing processes that we're going to use. And if we can think ahead and design our prototype this way, we will be in really good shape. But I will warn you about something, and this is the mistake that most people make when they're first starting out as inventors, and I made it too when I didn't know how these different processes worked. I'm trying to save you from this trouble. If you guys out there start talking about 3D printer technology and how it is able to make just about any shape, and that's what you're gonna go with for manufacturing, I'm gonna warn you now that you just priced yourself out of the market. Not only that, but are you willing to get in an airplane with parts that were made by a 3D printer? I'm telling you right now, I wouldn't fly in that airplane, and neither would you. 3D printing technology is great for prototyping and for small runs. Even F1 uses it to make parts in a hurry. But that's just for testing. In the end, you're gonna have to either go with CNC, injection molding, or even metal casting. And that's a whole nother process, again, that's beyond the scope of the first-time inventor. We wanna keep things simple so that we can make our parts cheaply. If you're gonna use processes like 3D printing, sand casting, and all those other very expensive ways to go, you're not gonna be able to sell your products in any reasonable quantities where you can make a good living. Trust me, I've tried. I have plenty of 3D printers here, and the only thing I use them for is for testing the fit and form of my products. And now, with my experience as a designer, I can design all my parts in SolidWorks or Fusion 360, test the fit and function of each, and pretty much know how they're gonna turn out in the end. Many of my products I have designed without making prototypes and have gone right to manufacturing. I don't recommend that for you guys. It takes experience and familiarity with the software and also the manufacturing process because there are tolerances and fits. When we drill a hole, we have to know how big the hole needs to be so that maybe a rod fits through that hole or screws or things like that. And remember, the size that we drill at isn't necessarily the finished hole size, not only because of expansion from heat and other factors, but also from anodizing that leaves a very thin coating and makes it hard to put screws in, and other things that can happen along the way. So these are things you learn as a designer, that allow you to go right from software directly to manufacturing. Again, I don't recommend that. For me, since I'm only making 100 pieces to start, it's not a bad way to go. Especially in electronics, where we make a board, we test it once, and then we go right into manufacturing of 100 PCBs. By then, we know that the only problems that are usually going to occur are changes in component values, and that's easy enough to do even manually on 100 pieces if they have to change one resistor or capacitor. And that has happened to me many times, and it's not a big deal. And it really doesn't cost that much, because we build so many boards, it takes somebody maybe 20 minutes to a half hour to change the component on 100 pieces. So these are things to keep in mind. Again, it's not for the first time inventor. Always go to prototype. Make that prototype exactly the way it's going to be for manufacturing, and then go into manufacturing. You won't go wrong. But remember, when you design not for 3D printing. You don't design for your laser cutter. You don't design for your home CNC mill. You design to manufacture the cheapest part you can with the best quality. And that takes a lot of skill and experience. But it's easy for you to learn if you just pay attention to all the videos that we're going to be doing here.